South Africa promotes its gold to the world. But the real story of South African gold is gold that most of us will never see. Gold stored underground in Switzerland and other countries. Thousands of bars of gold in the banks, transported from South Africa, where it was mined deep underground. South Africa's gold mines are the deepest in the world. The gold is found up to 4 kilometers underground. It can take an hour to reach it.
When I started work at a mine, I was 21 years. And at that time, I didn't know exactly what a mine is, because I was just going there to look for a job.
Samson Motseki worked underground for 8 years.
And when you came there at underground, you have to do any job they said you have to do. And the white people were rough at that time. You can be easily killed.
Welkom, a gold mining town 3 hours' drive from Johannesburg. The town is as old as apartheid. Until recently, the gold fields around Welkom produced 1/5 of the world's gold. Wherever you look, a gold mine. But like in all South African towns, the black workers don't live in Welkom. They live in townships, squatter camps, and in the mine hostels. That hasn't changed even today. In Welkom's largest township, Tabong, life revolves around the gold mines.
The mining industry is the foundation of the South African economy. So we cannot run away from that fact. Now, the question again would be, what, for instance, black people benefited from the discovery of gold?
Gold, down in the earth.
Gold was discovered on the reef in 1886. By the 1920s, the gold rush had transformed Johannesburg into a prosperous city.
This time, prosperity has come to stay.
But the prosperity was built on the sweat of the mine workers, many of whom had been forced off their land in rural areas and moved into reserves. This was the muscle power of the mining industry.
They introduced a tax which one would pay it with money rather than the livestock one would have. And it used to force black peasants to go to the mining industry.
After apartheid was made law in 1948, the pass system was introduced. Workers had to have passes to stay in the towns. No job, no pass, and no right to be in town or to use the services there. So apartheid ensured a cheap supply of labour for the mines. Soon afterwards, the Swiss banks opened their first offices in Johannesburg and began to trade in gold with the South African government. The founders of apartheid saw their future in the gold trade and put down the miners' strikes brutally.
It was not really no difference between the state and the mining industry. mining industry used to own their own mine security force, which they will use. If their mine security force cannot cope up, it was easy for them to get the state security forces.
Sharpeville, 1960. 15,000 people demonstrate against the discrimination of the pass system. Protesters burn their passes. The police shoot into the crowd. 69 people are killed, most shot in the back. 180 are wounded. The United Nations condemns apartheid. Around the world, anti-apartheid movements are born. Protesters take to the streets in London. In South Africa, Nelson Mandela is arrested and sentenced to life imprisonment. Some investors withdraw from South Africa. The largest Swiss bank is asked, is apartheid necessary or desirable? Their response, not really necessary, but definitely desirable. South Africa is the largest gold producer in the world. In 1968, the Swiss banks formed the Zurich Gold Pool. Zurich became the most important gold market in the world. In 1969, the Swiss banks imported over 1,000 tons of gold, half the world's annual production. Three quarters of this came from South Africa. Swiss bankers encouraged their customers to buy gold from South Africa and to buy shares in the mines.
For a very long time, the Swiss banks were the main counterparties of the South African government for gold sales, and I think this is how their position became established and entrenched, and they had very substantial influence and relations with the South African government of the day.
People who were enjoying gold is people overseas, because this gold has worked so many things for them at overseas. In our country, we didn't see anything.
After working in the mines for 8 years, Samson Motseki was involved in a serious accident underground.
The side wall fall first, and then the top fall on that. I was close under.
As Samson lay pinned down by the rocks, he heard his boss talking about him.
Say, no man, you can just put, he said to his supervisor, you can just put bombs here, man. We can finish now and go. We can't get that person alive. But the other man, the other chap, I'm still remember his name. Biza, he said, no, that chap is still alive.
Samson was eventually rescued from the mine.
I go there at medical station. I must report as usually how I'm feeling. They say, you still here again. You supposed to be at job. Say, hey, you gaffer. Why you have not been at your job? You were at hospital again. What are you doing there? I hear you said to the medical station there you get the accident underground. I say to him, yes. He say, fuck you, man. Don't come with nonsense here. You are fit. You don't want to go to the job. You run away to the doctors and medical station all over there. You report nonsense. While I'm looking at him, he just pulled me with my T-shirt and pull that window down. I must come and push the window with my forehead. The mine situation that time, it was the time of the slave trade. Slaves. So many people have died at the mine. They don't even their family didn't get anything.
1976, opposition to apartheid flared again, this time with the school children of Soweto in the front line. Again, police shot into the crowd. This time, hundreds were killed, thousands injured. The United Nations condemned apartheid as a crime against humanity and expelled South Africa. But the gold trade picked up. The price of gold skyrocketed, and in 1980 it reached an all-time high of $850 an ounce. This was a dream come true for the apartheid government. It had all the money it needed to invest in building up the homelands and crushing all resistance.
The high gold price would enable the apartheid regime, for instance, to get weapons all over the world where they wanted it to, because they would be able to exchange gold for weapons.
But the gold boom didn't last. In the 1980s, the gold price fell dramatically. The economy plunged into crisis. In the townships, black people suffered more than ever. The mass democratic movement was formed, and the call went out internationally for sanctions against apartheid.
Come and share with us.
During the crisis, the apartheid government was forced to look for financial help from around the world. In 1984, South African Prime Minister P.W. Botha came to see his old friends in Switzerland. In that year, his government took 7 international loans. 4 were arranged by the Swiss banks. Swiss banks were the second most important lenders to the apartheid government, after the English.
I think we are making friends in Switzerland, and the more friends we are making, even in a neutral country, the more the world can live at peace.
But there was little sign of peace in South Africa. In 1985, the apartheid regime sent 35,000 soldiers into the townships. 800 children were arrested in Soweto alone. This was the state of emergency. No end to apartheid was in sight.
I say that they will not succeed. They will not succeed. If necessary, we will use stronger measures, but they won't succeed.
P.W. Botha's hard line let loose a wave of international criticism. The sanctions movement made it into the United States Senate.
If you are a black man or a black woman sitting in a segregated neighborhood being brutalized, and you are told the last best hope for mankind, the United States, has turned its back, what peaceful alternative do you have? Mr. President, it's time to act.
Little by little, sanctions were imposed on South Africa's gold. The United States banned the direct import of gold bars from South Africa. But the Swiss banks were not impressed by the call for sanctions.
I think the Swiss banks, by and large, ignored it. They took the attitude this was an issue of business, and it wasn't unless there was a European initiative or a Swiss government initiative coercing them to do something like this, they were going to act in line with their risk perceptions, and they were going to price in line with the risk perceptions, which of course they did.
So the Swiss banks put up their prices and went on doing business with Pretoria. But in 1985, an American bank, Chase Manhattan, suddenly pulled out of South Africa.
I'm not in a position to tell you how much of that was a commercial decision, how much of that was a political decision, but it became an event where that, when that brick was taken out and the brick wall was threatening to collapse, it was literally like everybody trying to get out of a narrow door.
There was crisis in Pretoria. Banks refused to lend, and the government was unable to pay its debts. With pressure from the masses and internationally, there seemed no way to save apartheid. But to the rescue came Switzerland, and in particular, Fritz Leutweiler, former president of the Swiss National Bank.
The way must lie through reforms, and not through revolution and civil war.
Fritz Leutweiler negotiated on behalf of South Africa with the world's banks. He got the banks to give South Africa a 2-year break from paying its debts and 15 years to make the repayments. He refused to use the deal to force Pretoria to dismantle apartheid. Leutweiler gave the South African regime a breathing space, and the violence in the townships continued. But not everybody in Switzerland was impressed with the role of their banks. Weekly protests were held in the central square in Zurich. The call for sanctions spilled over into the Swiss parliament, where there were fierce debates. Let's be honest about this. Our businessmen just want to do business in South Africa at any price, and this policy is not a good policy for our country internationally. One of these days, it's going to come back and haunt us. As far as I'm concerned, sanctions will just promote extremists on both sides in South Africa. Over 100 calls for sanctions were rejected by the Swiss Parliament. The majority of MPs were also directors of companies investing in South Africa. Some customers began to withdraw their accounts from the Swiss banks, demanding that they withdraw from South Africa, a demand which bank president Niklaus Senn did not take seriously. This is an old, old story. I am confident that lending to South Africa is a much better way to gradually get rid of apartheid, rather than pulling out and leaving the blacks jobless. This will just strengthen the revolutionary movements, which can mean nothing but bloodshed.
Those who wanted to support apartheid had those excuses. You see, but I don't think he can say those words today, because he has been proven wrong. But not necessarily that he didn't know. He knew what was right and what was wrong, but he decided to be ignorant, even though he was not ignorant.
Hello, Aubrey. How are you, my son?
This is our dining room. This is my mother. This is my two younger brothers. Sien and Gift.
Samson lives with his 6 children in a shack. They have an electric light in one room. They struggle to pay their water bills.
This is my room with my 2 younger brothers. I sleep here with my younger brother, and the other one is sleeping there.
Samson's son Aubrey is a Technicon student. He studies by candlelight. On Saturday, the family eat chicken. During the week, they can only afford vegetables.
Thank you, Father, for the food.
And sometimes when there is storm, then we have a problem with this kind of building. And sometimes when it's raining, you can see water is getting inside.
In the last years of apartheid, the struggle was bloodier than ever. The system used the strongest repression. In the late 1980s, 1,500 political prisoners were in apartheid jails. But finally, the economic crisis, the mass democratic movement, and the international call for sanctions forced Pretoria to negotiate. In 1990, Nelson Mandela was released after 27 years in prison. Four years later, he was the first democratically elected president of South Africa.
Comrades and fellow South Africans, I greet you all in the name of peace, democracy, and freedom for all.
But Mandela's new South Africa didn't have an easy start. The government inherited a foreign debt of more than 125 billion rands, a debt that was built up by the apartheid regime. South Africa today. Half the population live in poverty. 40% are unemployed. A quarter of Africans live, like Samson, in shacks. Half have no water or electricity. Life in Tabong is harder than ever as mine companies move elsewhere in search of higher profits. Samson still works for the gold mines. Together with the other injured miners, he fixes lamps for the next generation of gold miners who are underground extracting South Africa's mineral wealth. In the last 10 years, 5,000 workers were killed in South Africa's gold mines. 100,000 were seriously injured. Tabong Cemetery, Free State, Aletta and Jackson at their son's grave.
I'm not comfortable until there is a tombstone on the grave of my son.
A metal plaque shows the short life of Albert Ntoyesile Kamfu, born 1966, died 1987, reburied 1991. A typical fate of a young freedom fighter in South Africa.
All of us were fighting for the freedom. We want to get freedom.
Because those days was the days of apartheid.
Like many young people, Jackson and Aletta's son went into exile to fight apartheid. He left home suddenly in 1984. For the parents, it was a difficult time.
When he left home, oh, my heart was broken. I feel so sorry. But the thing is that I don't know where he is and there what he's going to do.
1987, South Africa in flames. Albert Kamfu is shot. But his parents only discovered this 4 years later.
After they have killed him, they cut him a photo like this, a half cut. There was so many holes through his body of bullets. Without this one, unless this one, at his forehead.
Why they shoot my son like a dog, maybe like a what? So many wounds. At least this one I can maybe, but not so much. Like they kill maybe a dog or something, I don't know.
1996. In the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, South Africa sought to come to terms with its bloody apartheid past. Jackson and Aletta took their son's case to the TRC.
I only make a statement through the TRC and leave the message there. TRC that I don't know who killed my son. Would you please, as TRC, try by all your means to find out who killed my son?
Many violent deeds and crimes were revealed to the Truth Commission. Not all were solved. The TRC recommended that the victims be compensated.
You know, you can't really compensate somebody for the loss of a relative or a dear one. And so by its very nature, reparation is symbolic. But what it is meant to do is to improve the quality of the life of the individual, as well as make a public acknowledgement of the wrongdoing done to him or her.
They gave us just about 2,900. That's the only reparations we get from the TRC.
The South African government has been slow to come up with the full amount required for reparations. The Truth Commission is now looking to those who benefited from apartheid to make reparations to its victims.
The South African government was able to finance its rollover by extensions of loans from the major Swiss banks, Credit Suisse and the UBS. And one should remember that during that period, the Defence Force was able to in fact engage in an even bigger war upon ordinary people in the townships because of the assistance of those banks. So the violence that took place during that period should be laid firmly at their doors.
What do the Swiss banks feel about their role in apartheid, bloodshed and violence? From the largest bank, UBS, no comment.
We don't want to wait 50 years like the Holocaust victims, and we want this delivery to take place now.
Archbishop Njongonkulu Ndungane is another leading campaigner for reparations from the Swiss banks.
Those banks contributed indirectly to the delay of a transfer of power to a democratically elected government. And so in the challenges and the problems that we have discovered vis-a-vis, for instance, this huge apartheid caused debt affecting our country and our neighbors, we feel that there should be something that is done by way of reparation and compensation to aid the process of reconstruction in the region.
In January, the Archbishop headed to the World Economic Forum in Davos, Switzerland, to raise this issue. He was invited to address the businessmen and world leaders at this elite gathering. His first contact with the Swiss authorities, a police helicopter, but he remains optimistic.
I would like to make an intervention in terms of the whole question of debt, the issues of globalization. Let's see what we'll find in the meeting.
Also on her way to Davos, Yasmin Sooka from the TRC. She's not invited to the World Economic Forum, but intends to appeal directly to the Swiss people.
To get the debate on the table and to get those countries who supported apartheid, to have them start thinking about what they can do voluntarily before the issue becomes what, like the Jewish, the World Jewish Body, in fact, forced upon Swiss banks.
Halfway up the mountain, Yasmin Sooka gets a taste of the security preparations for the World Economic Forum. Anyone who looks like a demonstrator is searched and turned away many kilometers before Davos. Yasmin feels like she's back at home in days gone by.
It's like being back in the old South Africa again. Lots of police trying to keep people out.
The World Economic Forum opens with a taste of Africa.
We are here today because we are committed to the mission of the World Economic Forum to improve the state of the world. We want to help to bridge the divides.
The Archbishop checks in to the World Economic Forum. But in the key session on debt relief for Africa, the Archbishop finds himself sitting in the audience, not on the panel. Instead, he is invited to address a session entitled World Religions, Where Are the Peacemakers?
To resolve our differences and not lead into a violent conflict and differences escalate, I think that's the process you must engage into.
At a lunch on the theme of globalization in Africa, the Archbishop takes his own initiative and asks specially to be given a chance to speak. He's given 3 minutes.
Right. I'm not going to preach. What is actually needed
is an imaginative recovery plan for Africa on the scale which was done for Germany, for Europe, after the World War II, called the famous Marshall Plan, but address that recovery plan for Africa as a way of reparations for what has gone on in the past. I thank you.
The reaction in the room, a stony silence. How did Archbishop Ndungane feel?
I think that I felt that on a different wavelength with the people in that room. And I think the editor or former editor of the Business Days, when I came to sit down, says, I don't agree with you totally. I said, that's your opinion.
Well, the Archbishop is an Archbishop, isn't he? He takes care of the church.
President Thabo Mbeki was also at the World Economic Forum. What does he think of the call for reparations?
It's that sort of NGO call. It comes from that. Certainly is not part of our planning. We've never made any such call ourselves.
But some Swiss people had come to support the reparations call. They handed over symbolic banknotes.
That is part of the money we should give back to South Africa. And therefore I would like to give you this as a little part.
Thank you for this. We thank the Swiss people for this gesture of giving back to South Africa symbolically the money that she is entitled to. This is restorative justice and justice for those who suffered and those who died for the struggle. Thank you.
On the main day of the World Economic Forum, the Swiss police took a hard line, closing half the mountain. Opponents of the World Economic Forum were turned away. But some managed to squeeze through the police checkpoints to hold their own forum, Public Eye, on Davos.
I need to say, of course, that I have known Switzerland is very beautiful. I've never seen so much police and military as I've seen this time. Checkpoints in Switzerland! That's the last thing I ever imagined would happen.
The alternative forum was attended by NGOs and Swiss members of parliament. Yasmin Sooka brought home her message.
How much money was made by the banks of Switzerland on the backs of those in South Africa?
Out on the streets, some of the protesters faced water cannon from the police. And then most were sent back down to Zurich in a special train courtesy of the Swiss police. In another train, Archbishop Ndungane headed back to Zurich. He sounded a little less optimistic.
There's no tangible results. It's the organizers that invite people. I can't say why am I not included. But it's very interesting that one has been sidelined into what may be called churchy issues, like spirituality and religion.
Some of the protesters who'd been sent away from Davos took out their frustration. Yasmin Sooka sees a hard struggle ahead.
Looks like a place where there's been a war. Yeah. And you just wonder what happens from now onwards. This is a sign of things to come.
Sunday morning, Zurich Cathedral. Archbishop Ndungane is asked to address the congregation.
What a way to begin the new millennium, with this country having to mount one of the biggest combined police and military operations since World War II in order to silence the voice of protest. in one of the most respected democracies in the modern world.
Back in South Africa, Aletta is at a funeral. The deceased is another mother who lost her child to apartheid violence.
The government promised us after TRC we'll get a reparation for our children. Now we're still waiting. And many people are dying now. We are so worried. Many people are dying. The parents for those children.
For Aletta and the other parents who lost children to the struggle, still no tombstones.
We are suffering. Although the government promised us to give us that money. And she promised us she will give us the money. He will give us the money to make the tombstone for our children. Until now, got nothing.
I mean, there was a specific request by the ANC and the liberation movement mm-hmm. in South Africa for sanctions against the country. And as far as I'm aware, and as far as the Archbishop said, many Swiss companies ignored that call and continued to invest.
Yes.
You don't feel that it
No, I think we were right. I was against sanctions because the only thing they do, they make the poor poorer. I'm fully convinced that we were right to continue investing, that we certainly, through this, we didn't prolong, but we shortened apartheid. Apartheid was abolished for political reasons, but underlying was the economic development. And if there hadn't been international firms and large South African companies, like, for instance, Anglo-American, apartheid may still be there.
One of the points made by the Archbishop in his campaign is that Swiss banks and other businesses made quite substantial profits during those years, and he's now calling for a payback, a reparations comparable with the Holocaust reparations. How do you feel about that?
I think it's the right and the obligation of any business to make a profit.
So you don't feel that he has a moral case to make for reparations in South Africa?
I don't think so, no.
And you think it's the right of any business to make profit, even under circumstances where the government is using quite a lot of military force to repress the population and where there's a racial system in operation, like?
I think these are economic laws, and whether you have a right or not, if you make losses, you won't exist anymore after a while. Therefore, you have to make a profit.
Is there not a time where there's a moral responsibility not to go on making a profit in a country where you disapprove of the political system?
I don't think so. I don't think it's realistic to expect that. There are different laws than in politics. I mean, whether we liked it or not, that's another question. We didn't like it. That's quite clear. But as I said before, the way you can help to change things is for a foreign company not so easy. So what we can do, as I said before, we can talk. But if we start exerting pressure, that's counterproductive.
Do you think Switzerland is doing enough?
Well, look, I mean, certainly anybody could do more, but I would say that's a good start, isn't it?
Is it fair to make comparisons with the amount of money that Swiss banks and institutions made over the years and to ask if this is 0.02% or something, is it a good enough start? Do you think it's fair to?
I would say, look at how many companies do anything at all. I mean, look who does things like that. And I think, therefore, it's a good initiative. It can certainly grow, but it's a good initiative. Have you ever seen in many countries companies looking outside their direct economic interest? That doesn't happen so often.
So it's better than nothing?
Certainly.